have a new name for the coronavirus.
It's been almost a month since the first case of COVID. This virus doesn't discriminate.
It attacks everyone.
I want every American to be prepared.
And more than 40,000 people have been infected worldwide.
I have today declared that the coronavirus presents a public health emergency in the United States.
This particular case could be the first possible instance of community transmission of COVID-19.
It will create havoc.
We can talk about vaccine hesitancy. It's certainly understandable. Some people really have really sincere, legitimate reasons for being hesitant.
There is a subcategory that is afraid about the speed at which the vaccine was developed.
And people are worried that this is something that was rushed through.
The speed of development for this COVID-19 vaccine was actually an incredible effort.
It really wasn't rushed through. You know, when we look at the messenger RNA technique, it actually isn't particularly new. It took decades to develop.
The technology behind these vaccines are very old. It's been in development for the last 30 years.
It's still hitting us. It's extremely difficult to predict who's going to die from COVID and who's not going to die from it.
With COVID-19, I do have a personal involvement in it. My mom, who's actually was an amazing doctor back in Ukraine, she contracted COVID-19 and she died within a week. And my dad threw all kinds of resources, the best medications, everything that was shown to be proven to treat it, and nothing we could do. That really influenced my outlook on what we do for this disease. People don't realize how bad it is until it's too late.
The pioneers are just amazing, incredible individuals. I mean, we're standing on the work that they did. So we have people like Edward Jenner, an English physician, Jonas Salk. You've probably heard about the Salk Institute. So these are the people who really helped with helping us develop vaccines.
One of the first known techniques to fight smallpox was this process called variolation. It was actually one of our first attempts at inoculation and vaccine. This is in the 1700s.
So if we go back to Edward Jenner, I believe it was 1749 that he first inoculated a young boy with cowpox from a milkmaid.
So Dr. Jenner actually took the pus from the hands of these lesions of the people that were milking the cows that had cowpox, and actually he injected it into the 8-year-old son of his gardener. So it was kind of risky, but the gardener did okay. And what he noticed with that from then on was he had a remarkable resistance. And from that, he then developed the vaccine that was based on cowpox. It has basically been credited with having saved more lives than any other human being in history. In the 20th century, smallpox actually killed 300 to 500 million people. If you look at the just comparative statistics, the entire United States today has only 350 approximate million people. So that would have been the entire population of the United States.
And that was the beginning of the variolation process that we used as a stepping stone to create vaccines today.
What happened with variolation was they actually took the scabs. With the scabs, they actually would grind it into a powder. And with the pus, they would make it into a small serum, and they would actually make small scratches on the skin, and that and actually apply the scab powder or the pus directly onto the skin of the patient. With that, it would allow the body to start to develop its own immune system and to develop its own antibodies and killer T cells, and then to develop an immunity. One of the more interesting phenomenon was, first, there was resistance to this. Dr. Cotton Mather, who was one of the proponents, his house was stoned, and he was actually run out of town a few times. So there were people resisting the development of this variolation a technique to approach smallpox.
You know, actually fear of vaccines is not new. Every major vaccinations had their own proponents and opponents.
Actually, much of the research already needed for development of this vaccine had already been completed. So this wasn't a brand new effort. This was something that was already in the pipeline with some of the key ingredients that were needed already available.
Available data, scientific data. You have to pull not just only one study, you have to actually get just a number of study. If somebody can get it for you and kind of digest and present, that would be great, you know. Otherwise, you have to do it yourself. So going back to people who are nervous and afraid actually of vaccines, I see as a legitimate concern. However, again, if people would be willing to just sit down and hear people out, or even, you know, just spend time and research themselves, or get at least, you know, the data looked at, I think that the fear would go away.
Just to go back to the speed, when people are concerned about the speed, what we have to realize is that, one, a lot of the technology that was needed was already available. And then, two, this was a collaboration among different governments, scientists. So can you imagine having all that brain power, all that capital coming together to protect our world? And so this global pandemic really spurred on this desire to create something that would protect us. And so as people worry about the speed, just remember there were way more people involved than ever before for a vaccine development, and across different countries.
In mid-December, we got the first notice of this new disease and coming out of Wuhan, China. On December 31st of 2019, the first death in the medical journals from this new disease was reported. By January 11th, the Chinese published the entire gene sequence of this new virus. And when it was actually announced, there were 15 labs in the world, actually, that had already been starting to work on a vaccine. So by January 11th, 15 different laboratories in the world had already been starting to look at the sequence and to develop a vaccine. So the messenger RNA vaccine is not new. The technology, the messenger RNA technology, was actually used to develop vaccines against the Ebola virus, and is actually currently actively being used to develop vaccines against influenza at this time too.
The question about personal freedom is a very, very important discussion. And it's really, really difficult, especially when you don't have a view of what's happening to other people and how your actions could possibly impact them. I think the best example we could use in medicine is smoking. We're all aware that back in the day, people could smoke anywhere they wanted to. And a lot of the movies or even the sitcoms we saw, I Love Lucy, she was smoking around kids, and that was really something that was normalized. But as we got to know more, we realized that smoking is dangerous, not only for the person who's smoking, but also for the people around them. And so if we take that same analogy with the COVID-19 vaccine and SARS-CoV-2 virus, we see that getting vaccinated is actually protecting other people as well. So while we have our own individual freedoms, we also have a responsibility to each other. And part of getting vaccinated is saying that I care about other people as well.